A reading from the book of Genesis. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. He said, Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had showed him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, Father! And he said, Here I am, my son. He said, The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar, on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. He said, Do not lay your hand on the boy, or do anything to him. For now I know you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham looked up and saw a ram, caught in the thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering, instead of his son Isaac. So Abraham called that place, The Lord will provide, as it said to this day. On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this, and you have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you, and make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven, and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of their enemies, and by your offspring shall all the nations of the earth gain blessing for themselves, because you have obeyed my voice.
Thank you. going in, the Israelites looked back, and there were the Egyptians advancing on them. In great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt? Let us remain, and let us serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness." But Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm, and see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians, whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to keep still." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward." But you lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry ground. Then I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, so that they will go in after them, and so I will gain glory for myself over Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and his chariot drivers. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gained glory for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots and his chariot drivers." The angel of God, who was going before the Israelite army, moved and went behind them, and a pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel, and so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up in the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night, and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them. All of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord, in the pillar of fire and cloud, looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels, which was very difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. As the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers, the entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea. Not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thus, the Lord saved Israel that day from the
Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is free from sin. But if we have died in Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives, he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus.
Thank you. Holy Spirit. Amen. I said at the very beginning when I was doing the housekeeping notices, I wasn't going to use the E word. I am now going to use the E word on behalf of Father Daniel, myself, the whole ministry team, a very happy Easter. When our children were both very small and still had bedtime stories read to them, one of the favourites, in theory, they enjoyed hearing, bracket, we enjoyed reading, was, "Can't you see, little bear?" If you don't know the story, little bear's problem is he's scared of the dark. Big Bear provides bigger and brighter lanterns. But whatever the size and whatever the brightness, nothing actually helps. For Little Bear, he's quite astute. He knows outside the cave where they live is an awful lot of darkness. And it doesn't matter how big or how bright they are, lanterns won't make a difference. Eventually, Big Bear takes Little Bear outside to look up at the night sky and to face his fears. Little Bear looks up and he sees the full moon and the Milky Way shining far above, splitting the darkness, and he is at last able fall asleep. And you might or may not be surprised to know that often by the time we got to that point, either Cridwell or Owain would be snoring happily. Of course, being afraid of the dark is something which is quite common, not just to little bears. But Matthew's account of the resurrection tells us about those who actually, bizarrely, were scared of the light. Sometimes you see, just sometimes, darkness can be easier to cope with. Even more than we have this Holy Week, those first disciples had lived through a roller coaster of events and emotions that first Holy Week. They'd been carried away by the cheering crowds screaming Hosanna to the Son of David on Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. They'd spent the festival in the city, vigilant in the face of fear of risk to Jesus from Jewish and Roman authorities. They'd experienced the intimacy of the Passover supper with Jesus in the upper room, and then fear, shame, despair and grief of the arrest, trial and horrific death. In such circumstances, the deadness of grief would probably be welcome, offering the chance to retreat into the dark and to stop feeling, if only just for a while. There's comfort in the dark, but a certain bleak peace. We then have the two Marys visiting the tomb early, knowing that it will be dark. They go to grieve. The bright light of a Jerusalem morning is shining around them. The darkness is in their hearts. Now that it's all over and the adventure of travelling with Jesus is at an end, they can do what women of that time and in that culture did, which was to weep for the dead and to carry on tending to the living. there is no more reason to be afraid. So it's not the darkness which shares the night of their wits, but the light. Light from two figures who in their mind ought not to be there. One of them is from another world, an angel. Someone in their mind who should not exist in the real world of the Jerusalem burial ground. The other figure should be dead and sealed in the stone cold tomb. Both of these figures break into the darkness of grief and despair with a searing white light of hope and joy. And the women are afraid. Grief they understood all too well. It had its rituals, its expectations, and they know what was expected of it and from them. But this is very different. This new, unexpected joy with a painfully bright light is absolutely terrifying. No doubt, in their grief, the walk to the tomb had been long and slow. Now, all is movement, and they run from the angel and the empty tomb, not knowing whether to scream or to sing. And as they do so, they run headlong into Jesus. Little wonder that they fall right at his feet. First words to them echo the earlier message of the angel of the tomb. Do not be afraid, but go and tell. Each of the four Gospels recounts the story of the resurrection in a distinctive way. None of them attempt to tell us what actually happened to Jesus between Good Friday and Easter Day, something which remains a mystery, albeit one influenced by centuries of church tradition. Instead, they attempt to show the effect of the resurrection on those who were there, those who encountered the risen Christ. Matthew describes an earthquake and the angel being like lightning. But he's not alone in describing the first reaction of those who experienced these events as one of fear. In a way, perhaps, as we sing Alleluia, the A word we've not been able to mention since Ash Wednesday, as we sing it in the darkness of this evening, it's probably not fear that we're feeling. The women at the tomb were right to be afraid, for a bright light had pierced the gloom of their world, and nothing would ever be the same again, for dark death had been overcome. All of the old, comfortable certainties had failed. Their world, the world, our world, been turned upside down. And there were consequences for that. There would be no returning to safety and domesticity for the two men. Now, there was a commission to spread the news. Then, two women were the first to receive the news of the resurrection. But not only were they the first to receive the news, they were the first to be given the permission to share it. And there's no safety for us either. And I have to say, no safety for you, Judy, as you approach the font. If the light of Christ's resurrection pierces our lives and into our hearts today, as resurrection people, we have a new life committed to the truth of God's overflowing love. This Holy Saturday night, as we greet the risen Christ and Easter dawns once again, the risen Christ speaks clearly to each and every one, commanding each and every one, do not be afraid, but go and tell.
So basking in the light of the resurrection, Judy, can you please stand? As we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, we remember that through the Paschal mystery, we have died and been buried with him in baptism. Judy, do you wish to be baptized? Faith is a gift of God to his people. In baptism, the Lord is adding to our number those whom he is calling. People of God, will you welcome Judy and uphold her in her new life in Christ?
With the help of God, we will.
In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvellous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. Therefore I ask, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God? Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil? Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and men? Do you turn to Christ as Saviour? Do you submit to Christ as Lord? Do you come to Christ, the way, the truth, and the life? So I'm now going to anoint Judy with the oil of baptism, the oil of catechumens. These were blessed by the Bishop of Southwark on Monday, Thursday. So Judy, you're the first person in this year to be anointed with these oils. Judy, Christ claims you for his own. Receive the sign of the cross. Do not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified. Fight valiantly as a disciple of Christ against sin, the world, and the devil, and remain faithful to Christ to the end of your life. May Almighty God deliver you from the powers of darkness, restore in you the image of his glory, and lead you in the light and obedience of Christ. Amen.
Thank you. praise God who made heaven and earth.
Who keeps his promise forever.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Almighty God, whose Son, Jesus Christ, was baptized in the River Jordan, we thank you for the gift of water to cleanse us and revive us. We thank you that through the waters of the Red Sea, you led your people out of slavery to freedom in the Promised Land. We thank you that through the deep waters of death, you brought your Son and raised him to life in triumph. Bless this water, that your servant who is washed in it may be made one with Christ in his death and in his resurrection, to be cleansed and delivered from all sin. Send your Holy Spirit upon her, bring her to new birth in the household of faith, and raise her with Christ to full and eternal life. For all might, majesty, authority and power are yours, now and forever. Alleluia. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to profess together with this candidate the faith of the Church. Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the earth.
On the third day he rose again,
he ascended into heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father,
and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Julie, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Judy, may God, who has received you by baptism into his Church, pour upon you the riches of his grace, that within the company of Christ's pilgrim people, you may daily be renewed by his anointing Spirit, and come to the inheritance of the saints in glory. Amen. So I'm now going to remind everyone of their own baptism. It's only because I respect the organ. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. Amen. The peace of the risen Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit. Alleluia.
Thank you.
be present, Lord Jesus Christ, our risen High Priest. Make yourself known in the breaking of the bread.
Amen. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it
in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice, made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Rejoicing in God's new creation, as our Saviour taught us, we boldly pray in the language of our choice. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. Lord, our hearts hunger for you. Give us this bread always. baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, may receive the Eucharist this evening. If you'd like to receive a blessing, please come with your head bowed or with an order of service in your hand. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. God of love, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection has delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his risen life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Just a reminder before we have the blessing, as we are now officially in Easter, there will be a party after Mass, so do please stay for refreshments, so hot drinks, fizz, wine, and yes, please do, I'm sure there'll be some biscuits and offer as well, so please do stay after Mass and go to refreshment. There's chocolate! I don't know why we have that at Easter. So please do stand for God's blessing. The Lord be with you. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
God the Father, by whose love Christ was raised from the dead, open to you who believe the gates of everlasting life.
Amen.
God the Son, who in bursting from the grave has won a glorious victory, give you joy as you share the Easter faith.
Amen.
God the Holy Spirit, who filled the disciples with the life of the risen Lord, empower you and fill you with Christ's peace.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you this Easter and always.
Amen.